to really the line for not only reliability in the garden, but for really unique and special things about that line that bring out the best of that varietal.
Awesome. Super helpful information. Thank you. I love the knowledge there. I also want to know that it seems like a lot of the stock that you use, the genetic stock, is not really necessarily like market-based. We're not picking it because it's like something hot on the market, but picking it because it grows well in your region. I mean, a lot of the genetics that you just named start with how is that stuff? Say, pom-pom? Am I saying it right?
Yes, high and palm. Yeah, it's a Wintu word from the Wintu tribe that lived here, so it's not an English word at all. It's very very different sounding word.
And you say hayfork?
Yeah, so that's right. Yeah, outside of hayfork. Everybody, you either know what that means, or that just sounds just as weird. Like you live outside of hayfork, okay? It's really far out here, but you know, it's interesting that you mentioned that because we definitely weren't on a track to follow trends, but also I think we've always been aware of the trends and followed the trends either way, so they're going to affect what we know and what our context is. We do work with some trendy crosses. We had an amazing experience with a teacher of mine. She did a lot of work on genetics in the Bay Area and in Nevada County for many decades, and she brought us some amazing Sunset Sherbert. She had worked with Sunset Sherbert male pollen and did a really amazing, beautiful line of work with that, and Mother Chronic came from that. She placed 8th at the Emerald Cup last year, brand new strain, and so there are some blends of, you know, the traditional with the trendy, but ultimately what we're always looking for ourselves personally is things that are timeless, things that are going to withstand the test of time, you know, that are going to become great classics. And so, like, not every seed is a masterpiece. Like Beethoven was always erasing things, and then 9 symphonies in his whole life, you know, that were just freaking incredible. So not everything is going to be like a Beethoven symphony, but that doesn't warrant the process. It's all part of the process, and I just look at it as a process of art in collaboration with nature.
Coffee break.
And a lot of our stuff, you know, comes from genetics, but the way that specific phenotype shows up might be way more sativa leaning or way more like, you know, it looks like a true indica. You know, it's short and squatty and has these nice chunky buds, and then so you never really know what you're going to get when you're playing around with crossing things. And so we've over the years had some amazing strains that, you know, like one that we actually lost, and both my husband and I are like devastated by that, which was the Green Door, which was like a Romulan, came from like a Romulan was going around a lot here in Mendocino County for a long time, and something I don't see at all anymore. This great prom meal, and like you don't see that. But it came from that, and then we like crossed it with what my husband was calling the true Kush, and we have a lot of Blue Dream genetics in there. And so, over the years, that strain, we had kept it going, basically, and then we had lost it, lost during the fires in 2017 or something. We had a friend keeping our genetics in a nursery, and they had evacuated, so the genetics died. But another friend had some plants, and he crossed it with his Infinity Kush. So we got that green door back. We're calling it the door to infinity. It's one of my favorite strains, and like I just like I could like just live in it. It smells so freaking good, and I love the effects of it too. And the strain that came out of that Infinity Kush was actually really similar. Smelled really similar. We played with some of the genetics last year. We kind of chose our favorite from there, and then we got some more of those. Starts from him back again this year, so we'll be playing a little bit more with that.
Coffee and cannabis, come on, what's better?
Yeah,
thanks for joining me. I have 2 grams of organic flower in the Deuce, the Slug 33 Deuce, 2 gram unit. I am listening to Farmers Surviving the Transition on the Future Cannabis Project YouTube channel. Let's do it. New blazer, torch,
short season
big
genetics.
Buddy.
A lot of our stuff is done right at the end of September, beginning of October. That the true Kush and that true arrow, those genetics are in a lot of just watching the scroll of pictures looking for it.
I'm trying to find the stuff you're talking about.
Two minutes. Maybe 1:35. We'll see. 1:30. We'll see.
Of the rain.
2 minutes on the button.
This last year, pretty close, but not all the way. And then our spring, for our household use is not really doing that great either. And so we've struggled. We just drilled 2 wells in one day. That the first one hit a little bit of water, and the second one didn't. We just hit like 2 gallons a minute, which is sad and not really something that's going to help us that much. But, 1,000 gallons a day is more than none. So we decided to cap one of them, and we're going to try again in another spot. But, we're really so we're gonna have to get a water haul. It's not really something that we want to be doing, and another expense, but it is what it is. So, you know, those short season plants are even better for that purpose, because then hopefully we can harvest earlier, you know, before the rains really hit, and be done and not use all of our water that we really need for fire safety and all that too. So yeah, so anyways, you know, over the years we played with a lot of different genetics. This year we tried working with autoflowers, and that's something that we've never really done on a large scale before.